Good evening, and thank you for joining the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services for tonight's Fireside Chat on COVID-19 vaccines. I'm so excited about this topic and the panelists we have in store for you all. My name is Dr. Cardra Burns, and I'm the Senior Deputy Director for the Division of Public Health. Tonight, we are honored to have with us Dr. Mandy Cohen. Dr. Cohen is the Secretary of the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services. We're even more honored to have the Reverend Dr. William J. Barber II and the Reverend Dr. T. Anthony Spearman as our guests. Bishop Barber, a nationally prominent figure on so many fronts. He presides as the senior pastor for the Greenleaf Church in Goldsboro. He's a political, civil rights, and social justice advocate. Bishop Barber serves as the president and senior lecturer of the Repairers of the Breach and co-chair of the Poor People's Campaign, a national call for moral revival. He is the president emeritus of the North Carolina NAACP State Conference, where he served for 12 years. In 2017, Reverend Dr. Spearman was elected and presides as the president of the North Carolina NAACP State Conference. He has been a member of and served this organization for more than 50 years. He's also an ordained minister with the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church denomination. And lastly, but certainly not least, his fight for civil rights includes his advocacy work on behalf of the LGBTQ plus communities. So tonight, this is our third Fireside Chat so far this year. We kicked off this series with Bishop Barber as our first guest. Also, we recently held a cafecito, and this is what we call our Spanish language live stream events. And we have so much more in store for you all. These live stream chats serve as one of many ways in which we work tirelessly to prevent the spread of COVID-19. We know that this virus had hit communities of color especially hard. So we are doing everything possible to ensure the equitable access of information about vaccines, resources to help people make their appointments, and ultimately ensure everyone who wants a vaccine has a spot to take their shot. But there's so much more to be done, and that's why we're here tonight. So first, I want to share with you a brief video. Let's take a look.
I just took it, Johnson & Johnson, one dose. And you're done. 14 days from this time, 30 days to full immunization. I took it today because I believe in the first principle of my tradition as a person of faith. I have to love my neighbor as myself. I have to care for my brother. My doing it outwardly can help other people have more of a commitment to the efficacy of this vaccine.
Today, I got my vaccine, and I am so grateful that I was able to get a COVID vaccine. I got the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. I was grateful that it's a one-shot dose, so it's one and done. So now I am vaccinated and I'm protected against COVID. So when it's your turn to get your vaccine, get that first vaccine that's offered to you. Any one of the three are going to be great at protecting you from COVID.
Now that's a perfect segue to begin tonight's discussion. So let's get started. I'd like to invite Secretary Cohen, Bishop Barber, and Reverend Dr. Spearman to start us off with a few remarks. Secretary?
Well, thank you, Dr. Burns. It's such an honor to continue the conversation with you, Bishop Barber. And thank you for joining us, Reverend Dr. Spearman. Bishop Barber and I, as you saw in the video, were able to get our vaccines together last Friday. And as you saw, we got one shot Johnson & Johnson vaccine. So in just about another week, both of us will be fully protected and immunized. I'm looking forward to our conversation tonight where we're going to talk more about the vaccine, about the progress we've made, but also on the more work that we have to do. I'm very committed, and so is my department, on making sure that everyone has the information they need about COVID-19 vaccine, but also that they have access to those vaccines. We're doing all we can to reach out to the American Indian, Latinx, African-American populations that have been so hard hit by COVID. And I thank you again for joining and look forward to the conversation.
Thank you, Secretary Cohen. Bishop Barber.
Let me thank God today for the life we have, and thank God for the work that Dr. Spearman is doing, the tremendous work that Dr. Cohen is doing. I think sometimes people are not used to people who engage in civil rights and protest. They think we're always in a mode of protest, but we protest because we believe in what should be right. But we also know very well how to come alongside someone. And when I was first called and Dr. Spearman was called, and we've been watching the secretary, somebody said to me one day that we have our own Dr. Fauci. I said, no, we have our own Dr. Cohen. and her work is somewhat harder in this sense. She's in the South, we've got a lot of challenges, but we can meet those challenges. And so I'm just glad to be a small part of anything that's done to save life. In my faith tradition, I'll stop here with my comments. One of the great statements of Jesus is, I have come that you might have life, might have life more abundantly. Now, interestingly, in that text, life there is Zoe, God's life. But if you have more of God's life, you will care more about other people's lives. And so, it's hard for me to understand anyone who claims to be a person of faith who is not doing everything they can in this moment to help others have abundant life, to save lives. And so it's our time. We can do this together, y'all. We have to do it together. And I'm just honored to be a part of this effort.
Amen. Thank you, Bishop. Reverend Dr. Spearman.
Thank you, Dr. Burns. And I am very, very appreciative for this opportunity to share with Dr. Cohen and Bishop Barber in this fireside chat. As the president of the North Carolina NAACP, which is the second largest state conference in the United States of America and the largest state conference in the South, I deem it a privilege to represent the approximately 125 branches, adult branches, and probably 25 youth and college division chapters across the length and breadth of the state of North Carolina. And I'm grateful today on this, the year anniversary of the declaration of the pandemic being declared back in 2020, and to be able to say, and are we yet alive to see each other's face? Glory and praise to Jesus give for his redeeming grace. I have been redeemed, and I thank God for the opportunity to have had the vaccinations and to be able to share with others some of the experiences that I've had, as well as some of the things that I would hope that they would also do and encourage them to do. So thank you for allowing me this opportunity.
Thank you, and thank all of our panel. So now I want to ask a few questions to you all about your personal vaccine experience. Bishop Barber, I would like to start with you. We saw in the video a few minutes ago that you received your COVID-19 vaccine. Can you tell us about it?
Yes. I had the opportunity to receive the Johnson & Johnson, the one shot. I'd been studying the other two. As I shared last time, my daughter's a PhD as well in public health. And so this is her field. And I talked to her about it. She said, Daddy, all of the three have great efficacy and move forward. I was surprised by how once you get in line, it's really not a long time. I did not have any side effects, just a little soreness, for about an hour or so. the staff was great. When we did, and we, you know, we did it outside. Mm-hmm. Those that, you know, say that, you know, worry even about something as needles, and we need to take that serious, because some people have a, you know, a petrified needles.
Yes.
I didn't know when they stuck me. I mean, literally, I was like, what? Because I was doing something else and talking, and the lady was talking to me, and she said, finished. And so, I mean, literally, it was that quick. And you think about that quick, so that you don't end up in a, with a respiratory on, a respirator on for that long, that quick, so that you don't, you know, have to go and see, is your oxygen level, are your oxygen levels staying at a rate that can keep you alive that quick, so that other variants of this disease can't touch you. I mean, just that amount of time to extend your time, to extend the time of others around you. I was looking today, while I joke a lot, I'm very serious about this issue of life, and I try to always do something every day to make me conscious of how quick mortality can be. So every day we get 86,400 seconds every day. And, you know, Dr. Cohen, I think I'm right. Anybody that goes without breath for about six minutes is high, 7 minutes is surely high, is probably gone. You know, if somebody suffocated you for 6 minutes, that's 360 seconds, which means if you multiply that, if you divide 86,400 seconds by 360 seconds, that's 240, which means 240 times a day you could have been gone. 240 times a day you could be gone. If for some reason you are without breath for 6 minutes, most of you not going to recover. I mean, there are places that come, but that's a long time. Stuff starts shutting down. And to think about in less than 10 seconds, you know, I was able to get a shot that could allow my 86,400 seconds a day to roll on a little while longer, as the old folk used to say. Look, y'all, don't let a few seconds keep you from many years. Don't let a few seconds keep you from seeing your grandchildren and your children's children and your wives and your husbands, you know, even some of your enemies, so you can pray for them, and they may not be, if you live a little bit longer, they might be your friend. You die now, they might be enemy. Don't let a few seconds, I mean, literally, pop, 10 seconds. Once you get to where they're doing the shot, it's that quick. Don't let something that can happen that quick, and you stay away from that, when that quick could actually allow you to have many, 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 many more seconds, hours, minutes, and days in this earth.
Thank you, Bishop Barber. And one thing I just highlighted and wrote down on my paper, so profound, a little time will extend your time. Secretary Cohen, you received your shot alongside Bishop Barber. How was it? And then can you tell us how you felt afterwards?
Well, thank you. I was certainly feeling a lot of gratitude and relief. When I think about vaccines now, I immediately think of hugs because I am most looking forward to the fact that in another week, I will be fully vaccinated, waited my 2 weeks after the vaccine, and I'll have the opportunity to hug my parents again for the first time in more than a year. They are also now fully vaccinated, and I haven't seen them physically in person in more than a year. And so for me, vaccines means I can hug those that I love again, which is something I've been looking forward to for a really long time. So I saw gratitude, relief, joy, you know, and similar to others. I did have a sore arm. I felt a little achy that night, but woke up the next morning, you know, feeling good again. And I knew that was my body working to build this immunity. So I was grateful. I was relieved, and I was certainly, certainly very happy.
Thank you, Secretary. Now to you, Reverend Dr. Spearman. You received two shots. Can you tell us about your experience?
Certainly. But before I do, let me just digress a bit to thank Dr. Cohen for the weekly convenings that she has had for the past few months, where the leaders of the African-American faith communities have come together to hear some of the statistics as it relates to the growing numbers of those being vaccinated. We certainly started very, very apprehensive about the numbers of African-Americans, and it seemed to have lingered at about 11% for quite some time, which concerned us gravely. But we knew that we had to get in there and do the work that needed to be done in order to get the word into our communities and encourage them to get the vaccine. So yes, I have had two shots, the first of which was February 4th. And actually I had a scare prior to that because I was originally scheduled for the 29th of January. And here in Greensboro, the about 10,000 people were their appointments were canceled. And so we didn't know when they would be coming back to bring another allotment into the Greensboro area. So I was calling around I was really acting like a chicken with his head chopped off, calling around to Raleigh and the neighboring counties to see if I could get in there and get my shot, because I was ready to go out and begin doing the work of encouraging people having had a vaccination to be able to encourage them to go forth and do theirs. So the first one was on the 4th of February, and I did it here at the Mount Zion Baptist Church. Wonderful facility. The people were very professional, got us in and out. That day was very frigid. It was very cold on that occasion. And we had to sit in our cars for about 5 minutes before our appointments. But finally, when we got in line, we got through the line in a rapid pace and got the shot. And of course, we had to remain for about 15 minutes. And after that, I experienced maybe a little bit of soreness in my arm, but nothing more than that. And then came back 3 weeks later on the 25th of February to the same facility and received my second vaccination. And like Bishop Barber said, I felt nothing both times. I mean, I was joking with the nurse about the needles that I had seen on television. And the needle, if it was as long as those needles that they showed on television, it didn't feel as though there was a needle at all. So but by the time she was finished, I didn't even know that I had had the vaccination. Rested again for 15 minutes and was released. And I have not had one symptom. There was some talk about doing some things prior to the vaccination, but I didn't do those. It was suggested to me, just go ahead and get the vaccination, and I did. And I'm glad that I did, and I had no symptoms whatsoever. So I thank God for that, and grateful to be fully vaccinated.
Can I say a word, Carter, on that?
Yes, of course. Yes, sir.
You know, when you think about this getting this vaccine, another thing I want people to be reminded of is, you know, to come to these vaccines, when you have a virus, there has to be a lot of testing. I don't know all of the Dr. Cohen knows, you know, there's a lot of experimentation. You know, people have to get in trials. Sometimes the trials work, sometimes they don't. I also, my grandmother, before she died, said to me one day, I need you to do something after I die. I said, what? She said, live. And we had this conversation about our obligation to live for those who die, especially if somebody dies tragically or dies. I mean, there's a place to cry over them having died, but there's a place that you live. I don't know if you all ever saw the movie that, what's the guy named Tom Hanks played in, and was about when he went to get the brothers. His family had four sons that died in the war, and he had one more. And he says to the guy when they're saving him, he says, make your life being saved worth it. Because everybody gives their life and he survives, right? But before he says, Tom Hanks looks at him and says something, I'm not quoting it exactly, but basically he says, don't let the sacrifice of other people be in vain. You know, there's a sense in which we've had nearly 500,000 people over die. We have a responsibility not to keep dying, but to start living. We have a responsibility to do, you know, a year ago, the pandemic was on fire. Now we should be on fire for getting this vaccine. And, you know, I know one fan of my church, I think I didn't say it last time, Secretary Cohen, 12 members in one family on this country. You know, I have one lady in the Poor People's Campaign, 25 family members within a 50 mile radius. She's 18 years old. Lost 25, she don't have no family. And she's waiting on her, you know, test now in Mississippi. And she said to me, Reverend Barber, all I know to do is now to live for, because I lost everything. All my family members gone. And they were poor and they didn't get, you know, there's a whole lot of reasons behind that. But we really, in the face of all this death, I think have a moral calling to live. And then I would add, live better. Not just live, but live better, you know. But we certainly have a responsibility not to. The pandemic had its chance. Now we have to take our chance. It was on fire. It's been on fire for a year. We got to get on fire by getting these vaccines.
Thank you. Thank you. So now I want to shift topics just a little. And many of you touched on this earlier. But Secretary Cohen, can you dive just a little bit deeper into the fact that there's been so much chatter around which vaccine people should get? And can you give us some thoughts on that?
Sure. Well, it's important to know we have three safe and effective vaccines. As Bishop Barber was saying, these are vaccines that are built on years of scientific work. They've been tested thoroughly. They've been in clinical trials with tens of thousands of people. And now here in North Carolina, we have given out almost 3 million doses of vaccine already. And so we know that all three of these vaccines are on par in terms of preventing the worst of what COVID can bring. And you were just hearing sad, awful, cruel things that this virus can do in terms of taking people's lives. But these vaccines all prevent hospitalization, all prevent death. I think that everyone should get this vaccine and importantly should get the first vaccine that is offered to them. And it's gonna be what helps us get back to the people and places that we love.
Thank you, Secretary Cohen. So my next question is really twofold for both Reverend Dr. Spearman as well as Bishop Barber. But I'll start with Reverend Dr. Spearman. What is the NAACP doing to help communities get vaccinated?
The North Carolina NAACP is the way that we are structured and our infrastructure allows us the opportunity in the counties that we are represented to really set forth the kind of messaging that I think our communities need. So most of our branch presidents are on board to get the vaccine and to encourage others to get the vaccine. We have been in dialogue and conversation on a regular basis in our meetings, most of which happen via Zoom these days, to do all that we can to make sure that we are helping our people to know where they can go to get the vaccine, what they need to do in order to sign up to get the vaccine, in many cases, you know, calling public health and things of that nature. So we are geared up to assist however we can to help people to get to the places that they need to get. Also, many of our branches have set up stations where they have people or they're able to provide transportation for people to get the vaccine. As you know, Dr. Burns, many of the people in our communities do not have transportation. And we think that may have had something to do with the low numbers of those being vaccinated, because while they have a desire to get vaccinated, they don't have the transportation to get to the places where the vaccines are being put in the arms of people. So we are trying to do all that we can to make sure that people are transported to these facilities, and just do everything we can to make sure that everybody is encouraged to get these vaccines, get these shots in their arms. So we have the young people, the Youth and College Division chapters are also geared up. Of course, many of them won't be able to get the vaccine until their time comes, but many of them are helping the elders to get to these sites as well. So they're starting up these, making people aware that they are available to get them to these vaccination sites.
And Dr. Burns, if I could, I just want to thank Reverend Dr. Spearman for the work the NAACP has done. But there are many, many organizations that have been just tremendous at the partnership in making sure that we are successful in getting vaccines out. And it shows in the numbers. I'm really proud that we are have been getting national attention for the fact that North Carolina is getting vaccines to the African American community. We know that African Americans are about 21% of the population, and week over week for the last 4 weeks, now going on fifth week, more than 20% of the vaccines each week are going to those in the African American community. And that is in no small part to the wise counsel that we have gotten from faith leaders across the state. But there are so many faith leaders and other community organizations that have partnered with us, and we're going to need your continued help. And I just want to say thank you for that. And it has been a tremendous effort.
Thank you, Secretary. And thank you again, Reverend Dr. Spearman. Anything you'd like to add, Bishop Barber, before we go into questions from the viewers?
You're on mute, Bishop.
There's nothing like having connectional organizations. And just like having served also as president of NAACP, one of the great things is that it has reach already, structure in every county. Doesn't have to build structure. And then when I hear what's going on with the denominational groups, that is a tremendous thing. You know, one of the things that we've been trying to do also in the Poor People's Campaign is to educate and motivate people within our poor and low wealth communities. You know, poor people and low wealth people, particularly poor and low wealth, were the first to have to go to work. Because this pandemic hit first among people who do a lot of face-to-face jobs, which are the jobs that are often the ones that have the lowest pay, the least amount of health care. And so people were the first to have to go to work, the first to risk themselves to keep the nation going, the first to get infected, the first to get sick, and many of them the first to die. And so we've been spending a lot of time in that community across the board, whether it be Black or white or brown, because I want to read something to you in just a second and why it's critical in this moment for three things to happen. And one is that we must make sure that we get the necessary supply. That's why we're so glad that President Biden has decided to be focused and decided to do everything needed to be done by even using the military, forget the title of it, but the Defense Act that you can use in the midst of a crisis to increase the what corporations can do and how it can be produced. So we must get the supplies. And then there's a second thing we also have to do is we must expand our use of servers or servicers, those who are giving it out. So yes, the drugstores and whatnot, but we have to use the churches and we have to use organizations that work in poor communities, white, Black, the churches. We have to use make sure that they get resources. You know, this is the kind of effort that the resources can't stay in the normal places. We've got to resource and source out to those organizations that have been working in at-risk communities and poor communities even before this particular pandemic. And then we have to constantly let people know the power they have. I'm so glad that the secretary in this state took something very seriously that we said. It was too easy for people to say at the front end of the vaccinations, the narrative that black people or brown people were suspicious and that counted for the low rate. Mm-mm. Yes, all people are suspicious to some degree. Actually, they did a study and said those who have been told the most not to wear masks and had listened to Trump, they were the ones the most suspicious. And there is, but we had to stop that because it becomes a cop out. It becomes a way of saying something and then putting the blame back on black community, brown community. And I'm glad that Secretary Cohen heard that and said, I'm not going to lean into that or use that as an excuse. What I'm going to do is make sure that we push out the supply and we push the services. And I want to encourage that to happen even more. Find all of those organizations that work anyway in communities and make sure they're getting resourced and used. And then I want to ask that we make sure that in the midst of this, that we target census tracts by poverty. You know, in North Carolina, we don't often talk about it, but in North Carolina alone, we have over 4.7 million poor and low-wealth people. Think about that, over 4.7 million poor and low wealth people. And one of the things that we are seeing now, tonight the president is going to be speaking about this first bill, this COVID bill, is for the first time in a long time, they did a bill mostly from the bottom up. The first COVID relief bill wasn't done like that. It was done from the corporations down for the most part. 84% of the money went to corporations. But this one is from the bottom up. And that's what has to happen here, not just for black communities, but for poor and low wealth communities, is that 4.7 million people. We have to hit those census tracts and examine what's happening. I'm glad that Secretary Cohen, I heard, you know, when you that is happening here, because in some places there is not a socioeconomic measurement going on. That's been one of a lot of the public health specialists I've talked to. That's been one of the failures in a number of places. We're not measuring how this disease impacted poor people, not just black people and brown people, but by race, but by socioeconomic measurement. And we were not looking at what is the impact of the vaccinations in poor communities. So I'm encouraging that we take that hard look at that, as where things are going. And then lastly, we've got to make sure that people understand we have the power to stop the spread. You know, sometimes in life you don't have a power to do something. There's nothing you can do. You just got to take it. But in this instance, you know, we literally have this enormous power. And I pray that we if we do it from the bottom up more and more, if you lift from the bottom, everybody gets lifted. You leave out the bottom, we're going to be inextricably tied to each other. There's no way around this. If every middle class and wealthy person in this state got vaccinated and the poor low wealth didn't get vaccinated, guess what's going to happen? It's going to continue to spread, continue to variant. So in this moment, we have to be one community, but we have to take a special look at poor communities, because that's where the disparities have already existed. As you heard me say this last time, the thing this pandemic has done, even before the vaccine, is expose the fissures of racial disparities and economic disparities. And I think it's important for me to say that across, because I'm worried about what's happening in Appalachia, just like I'm worried about what's happening down in the Black Belt in Eastern North Carolina. I'm not just concerned about what happens in Gates County. I'm also what's happening out there in Buncombe County or outside of Buncombe County. You know, those smaller areas. We have to make sure we check all of those census tracts and vaccinate from the bottom up.
Dr. Burns, may I interject?
Please do.
I really appreciate what Bishop Barber just finished saying in terms of, you know, from the bottom up. And one of the things that I want to make sure that we mention is one of the successes, another of the successes that has occurred during this pandemic that equates to COVID-19 relief. And that is that the North Carolina NAACP and some other coalition partners succeeded recently in getting a settlement from the state, which was going to realize some 3,500 early releases for those who are behind the walls. And I can't tell you how many letters that the North Carolina NAACP has received, cries from those who are behind the bars for some kind of relief to get into the walls of the prisons because they're suffering there and we're not able to exercise those mandates that have been put in place for the state of North Carolina for the most part. But we were able to get some relief in there, and that's going to be a tremendous when people may not realize it now, and people have questions about who is going to be released and whether it's going to be the hardened criminals and all of that. But the half has not been told yet about how that is going to bring about some change in our state and ultimately across the nation and then the world. This past February, we had the 15th annual historic Moral March on Raleigh, which we call the Historic Thousands on Jones Street. And there we framed our motto, or our theme was Hope in Action, living a new world into existence. That's what Dr. Barber talked about a little bit earlier, living a new world into existence. And we, those who are yet alive, have the ability to live this new world into existence. How are we going to do that? We claim that we don't want to go back to normal. There's not going to be any going back to normal. How are we going to express that in the way that we live going forward? And I believe that this is going to be a tremendous boon for those who have the opportunity to take a look at it. And hopefully there's going to be strides that are made with criminal justice reform going forward. So I just wanted to mention that because that if we want to talk about the least, the last and the lost, we're talking about those who are behind the bars.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can I ask one thing or say one thing real quick? And I know it's a conversation. Dr. Cohen, one of the ways you can frame that too is I had somebody, you know, every time then people try to be smart advocate with people. So they was like, yeah, the NAACP, you know, got all these criminals out. And first thing I said to them, well, you're one, you just haven't been caught. But then after that, I said, the second thing, I said, do you support police officers? They were, you know, the person, yeah, I support police officers. I said, well, what do you think is going to happen to the guards in there? And first of all, you ought to be concerned about the folk, because I don't care if a person stole a car, that doesn't give them a death sentence. Right. You know, there are people incarcerated who haven't even been tried. There are people people incarcerated. We have worked, Dr. Spearman and I, on numerous cases over the years of folk that were tried and convicted and on for murder and found out they weren't. So first of all, we have to be concerned from that standpoint. But the second part is you got all of these guards that go in, the nurses that go in and treat. They have families to go back home to. So again, one of the things that a pandemic does, it makes you realize that you are more connected to people than you realize. So we might as well help everybody because if we don't, we're not going to really move as we should. And lastly, somebody was saying to me about poverty, and again, they were trying to be smart aleck and said, but you're talking about black folks? I said, yeah, sure, black, poor, low wealth black folks. 60.9% of people in color in this state are poor, low wealth, or black. 2.3 million. But did you know that 2.4 million of them are white?
Exactly.
I didn't know that. We got to stop separating and come together. And this moment actually gives us the opportunity to do that.
Yes, and each and every one of us, no matter where we live, where we reside, the color of our skin, everyone has to get vaccinated right now.
Right.
And that's so important.
I'm going to tell you at the end if I can. I don't do it now, but it's something I had to tell a smart aleck guy about not taking the vaccine. I need to speak to men. But I'll do it at the end.
Okay. So I want to take just a couple of minutes to check and see if we have any questions for our viewers. We have tons of viewers right now and want to make sure that their questions can get asked to this esteemed panel. And so the first question is from Sally Wilkerson-Rice from Facebook. The question reads, where can I get the Johnson & Johnson vaccine? And so I'll kick that over to you, Secretary Cohen, to answer.
Great. Well, thanks for that question. So again, the Johnson & Johnson is a one-shot vaccine. It was the one I got and Bishop Barber got last week. The important thing to know is Johnson & Johnson just came out, and so their supply is very limited. We only got a very small amount of doses in North Carolina. We did send them to all places across the state, but then we know over the next 2 weeks, we're not going to get any more doses of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. But when we get to the first week of April, the federal government has said that's when we're going to start to see more of that supply improve. The way you can find that starting at the end of March, beginning of April, is that you can go to our website. It's yourspotyourshot.nc.gov. And there you can put in your zip code. It'll have vaccine locations for you. And when you are signing up for those appointments, you want to know whether or not you're signing up for the one dose Johnson & Johnson or the two dose. And so we're trying to help make sure you can navigate that. You can also call our call center. It's 1-888-675-4567. And they can also help you find a vaccine location near you.
Thank you, Secretary. We have another question from Ebony Hardison from Facebook. And the question reads, I'm still trying to figure out where I'm going to get mine because I can't stand in line too long. She has a medical condition. And so wanted to know what accommodations are available for those who may have physical constraints or disabilities?
It's a great question. Maybe I'll take that one as well. So we're trying a number of ways in which to make sure the vaccine's accessible. And there are a lot of sites that are drive-through. So you can actually stay in your car and you wouldn't have to walk at all. So that may be a really good option for you in your community. But if that drive-through isn't something that's accessible to you, there are a number of places, particularly I'd encourage you to call your health department, make sure they know that you have some physical constraints and talk through what could they do to help make sure you're not waiting in line. I'll just speak to the site that we just stood up in Greensboro, North Carolina. You may have heard we opened a big vaccine site in Greensboro at the old Dillard's that's at the Four Seasons Mall there. And what we are hearing, it's only our second day of it being open, but now it's open 7 days a week, 12 hours a day. Their appointments are coming online every few days. So you want to check back or you call our call center for those. But you're also in and out. There's drive-through, so you could just drive through and you don't have to wait, stand in line at all. But the entire process is taking less than 30 minutes total. Actually, it was taking about 23 minutes, and that includes the observation time. They folks do watch you for about 15 minutes after you get your vaccine. So it's a pretty quick process. So that's what we're seeing at most of our vaccine sites. As long as you can make that appointment ahead of time, that once you get in, it's a pretty quick process. So hopefully that will be okay with you in terms of your physical constraints.
They put that site in Greensboro because they postponed my first appointment. So
we knew we had to get more vaccine to Greensboro, and we delivered. We said we would be back.
I'm gonna take one last question from the viewers before we get back into our final.
And I have a question from someone they wanted me to ask tonight.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah. So it was basically someone that's deaf, and they wanted to know, is there a place where they can go where a person is signing and is running to the bottom that they can get all the information? And would you consider doing one promo with somebody who is deaf signing after they take that shot.
Well, Bishop Barber, I'm so glad you brought that up because, you know, one of the divisions within our department is making sure that we are doing everything we can to reach out to the community that is deaf and hard of hearing. We already have some of those materials and video of folks who are for those who are hard of hearing. So we'll make sure that gets shared with you and so you can share it with others. Again, if folks need to have accommodations like sign language, speaking other languages, we have those accommodations in a lot of different ways across our sites. I'd encourage folks to, again, call our call center to make sure where they are going for their vaccination site, it has those accommodations.
And the vaccine, one other question they wanted me to ask you to answer again. Somebody said, Grand Bobby, it's true that the vaccine does not put the virus in you, right? And I said, well, I'm gonna ask it again to Dr. Cohen so that they can, because people are really, that's a major question, yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you asked it because we hear that all the time. That none of the three vaccines inject the virus into you. So it's not a weakened virus or anything like that. So when you get this vaccine, it's actually teaching your body how to fight off COVID, but it is not injecting the virus in you at all. What it does is it trains your body in how to recognize COVID and build up its antibodies. So if you do see COVID, you'll be able to fight it off right away, but it does not have the virus in the vaccine itself.
So it's kind of like my mama was about the cookie jar. She trained, but of course she had a little ruler, but yeah. It kept training my body. They are like,
that's right. The antibodies will swipe away the COVID.
And so I'm going to take one more question from our viewers because it connects back to the first question, Secretary Cohen. And this question is from Lori Tomich from Facebook. The question reads, I thought Johnson & Johnson wasn't as effective.
Yeah, Lori, I'm so glad you brought that up about the Johnson & Johnson vaccine because there is a lot of data. You know, what's important to know is all three vaccines have the same effectiveness. They're on par in terms of preventing the worst of what COVID could bring, hospitalizations and death. What we have seen is there are different levels of effectiveness for milder disease. But what I would encourage you to understand is that these vaccines were tested at very different moments. The first two vaccines, Pfizer and Moderna, were tested earlier in the pandemic before this virus changed. And we know this virus is changing. That's what viruses do. They want to change. It's why there are new flu shots that come out every year is because viruses change. And so the Johnson & Johnson was tested a bit later and actually was tested in the context of some of this, the new viral changes. So, you know, that makes it hard to compare one to the other. But what I would say overall is from an effectiveness place is that all of them prevent hospitalization and death, which is what we all want to prevent. It's why I was comfortable getting the Johnson & Johnson. I know Bishop Barber shared. That's why his daughter, who's in public health, recommended it for him. And again, we think it's a good option and encourage you to get the first vaccine that's available to you.
Thank you. And so we'll check back in for questions a little bit later. And so now I want to shift us to a different topic, particularly now we know it's more and more people getting vaccinated in our state. And Secretary Cohen, the governor recently shared a great analogy around football, where he said, there's times in football when the runner nears the goal line and begins to celebrate too early. I'm a Dallas Cowboy fan, so I've been there, done there about celebrating too early. And it's the football stripped from them. He also said we can't get caught celebrating too early. Can you really break this down for us, the panel, as well as the viewers? What does celebrating too quickly look like as it relates to COVID-19? And what should people do instead?
Yeah, it's a really good analogy, because where we are in this moment is things are looking better, right, with COVID. Our cases are lower. There are less people that are in the hospital. That's all good. And we're seeing more and more people get vaccinated. More than 1 million people are fully vaccinated. And I said we gave out almost 3 million doses here. So things are headed in the right direction. And it can make you think, oh, we're done here. But unfortunately, that's not the case. We still had, you know, unfortunately, we're still seeing cases at the same level we did back over last summer, where we remember we were being very careful. And so we need to make sure that we are protecting each other in this moment as we speed up getting vaccine out. Now, I think over the month of March and April, we're going to be able to get vaccine out to more folks. We just announced today that we're going to be able to move to the next group of folks who are eligible. So those with a medical condition that might put them at higher risk for COVID are going to get vaccinated or be eligible starting this coming Wednesday, March the 17th. That's great. And the federal government has told us that more supply is on the way. So, right, we're saying we see that light at the end of the tunnel. However, there is still a lot of virus here, and I do not want to see one more person lose their life, lose a loved one to this cruel disease when we have the tools to protect each other. That's why we need to be wearing a mask to protect each other and while we work to get vaccine to everyone. It's still going to take us a number of months to be able to get vaccine to everyone who wants it. So that's why we're going to have to keep protecting each other. But I promise this will end. This will end. Just bear with us a few more months as we work hard together to keep this virus level low. One other thing I'd say is that keeping that virus level low helps us with all those virus changes. Remember, I was saying that the virus is changing and wants to change. But if we do a really good job now of keeping virus level low and we get vaccine out quickly, that we'll be able to get the jump on COVID and make sure we're not seeing a more contagious form or a more severe form of the virus develop.
Thank you. So I have another question from our viewers. Denise Spa, and I apologize, Denise, if I'm messing up your last name, from Facebook asks, who can churches partner with to offer vaccine? And so it'll be good to hear from you, Reverend Dr. Spearman and Bishop Barber, and just how you all have been partnering to increase vaccine access points in your communities.
Well, one of the partnerships that I have seen become very successful over the past couple of months, or at least a month, is the North Carolina Council of Churches has been partnering with some churches in areas to host sites for the vaccine. And that's happening quite a bit now in the African-American community. So we're very pleased about that. And and churches, well, let me mention this as well. I have been a part of a partnership with the Duke University Hospital for about 5 years now. The African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church has been partnering with Duke University, and we focus on trying to increase the number of people in the African American community and the church to be able to, desire to be a part of clinical trials. And so, you know, we, the pastors in the church, have been modeling before the people to get involved in that very thing, to try to dispel all of the myths that we find in our communities that are present among us because of some of the things that happened years ago with the syphilis, Tuskegee syphilis study, and the whole notion of Henrietta Lacks and how what happened mm-hmm. to her. But we're bouncing back and getting information to people. You know, if you it's been said that if you know better, you'll do better. And so we are trying to help our people to gain more knowledge and information about some of the things that are out there for them, because we are the ones that are, you know, disparities are plagued in the African American community with diabetes and all of the other diseases that we seem to get. And so we are doing all that we can to do as much partnering as we can with as many organizations and agencies as we can. With regard to that previous question that you asked about not celebrating too soon, that's something that I really, really hold near and dear to my heart. And even though I've been vaccinated twice, I've received my full vaccinations, I still don't leave the house without my masks. Both I wear two masks, the N95, and I wear another mask on top of that. So whenever I go into the office, whenever I go to the store or anything of that nature, I have my masks and I put them on because I want to protect others. And I want to, protect others from, they don't know that I've had the vaccine. So, I want to make sure that we're protecting those who we come into contact with and modeling before them what we would hope would happen with them as well. So thank you for the question. And I really, really appreciate, I can't say enough about some of that which has been happening, and I'll sing the praises of Secretary Mandy Cohen until the cows come home. That's one reason she was invited. She was invited to the Moore March on Raleigh this past year, and did a splendid job of being able to communicate with those who saw and it was live streamed for the first time, and I think it was a very magnificent demonstration of coming together and coalition building. Thank you, Dr. Cohen.
So Denise says one more follow-up question.
Right.
And
I want to say something about that church piece, but go ahead.
Okay. And we're actually about at our last 4 minutes, so we can put it in your final remarks too, Bishop. So Denise asks, Secretary Cohen, could you repeat the phone number to the call center?
Oh, sure. It's 888-675-4567. That's an easy one.
Okay. Yeah. And Dr. Spearman, I think you mentioned that. I think people should go back. Actually, the Mar March was always live streamed, but the difference is the way in which it was presented, and people can still go get it. So that's something we need to say to churches. People will say, well, who's coming to partner with me? I'm going to ask, who are you going to partner with? Because of the church of faith bodies, we're supposed to reach out, not sit in. I mean, we may sit in civil disobedience, but we're not supposed to sit in and wait for folk to come to us. We're supposed to go out. So this is time. We should be going into the hedges and the byways and the highways. You know, this program tonight, you take one of your Bible studies and play this for an hour and then have a conversation. You know, get one of the techies in your church to cut out just the sections that Secretary Cohen, the quick answer she gave, and put it on a tape and play it on Sunday morning, those of you that are live streaming. Use that as the opening or as a part of your service. I hope, Secretary Cohen, every church that is right near a housing project should be reaching out saying, we want to become a center. I'm going to say it on camera tonight. Easter Monday and Easter Sunday, that weekend, I want to be a site on East, because we're right, 75 feet from a housing. Every church that you're right there, you should be reaching out, finding ways. Every mosque, every synagogue, reach out, want to find out, seek ye first, seek it. And let's not just put it all on the secretary to come to us, but there's a sense in which we need to come and bring ideas. Everybody can bring criticism, but bring ideas. All these radio stations that we're on, every pastor, all these cable shows, let's turn them on so to be used in a way that will save life. And then lastly, I just wanted to say, like Dr. Spearman, you got your mask, keep your mask with you. Keep it with you all the time.
Did we lose you, Bishop? So we'll move on to last, just some other final remarks. Secretary, do you have any before we wrap up tonight?
Well, first, I wanted to thank Dr. Spearman and Bishop Barber for their ongoing partnership. I think this is a great discussion. I think we covered a lot about the safe effectiveness of vaccines, the fact that we want folks to know when they are eligible and to get their vaccine right away. But I think importantly, Dr. Spearman brought up a good point about even when you're vaccinated, I talked about vaccines equaling hugs for me, and that's great. When you are fully vaccinated, you can now be with other vaccinated folks without wearing a mask. But when you are out in public, even after you're vaccinated, we ask that you continue to wear a mask in order to protect each other, as well as role model that good behavior of protecting each other and caring for one another as we go through this. I'm so grateful for all of the partners that we've had the opportunity to work with over this whole year. Hang in there. We are doing great work here in North Carolina. I'm so grateful for that. But there's more work to do. Make sure when it's your spot to take your shot to beat COVID. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary. Thank you, panel. Thank you to our viewers for your time tonight. I don't know about you at home, but I learned so much great information. And so this concludes our fireside chat on COVID-19 vaccines. We invite you to follow the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for the latest information, as well as details for our next fireside chat. Until then, please visit yourspotyourshotnc.gov to learn more about COVID-19 vaccines. And remember, layering mitigation efforts is essential to reduce the spread of COVID-19. That means get your shot, continue to get tested, and continue to practice your three W's. Wear your face covering, wait 6 feet apart from others, and wash your hands. Good night, everyone.